que ya viene la revolución, para que se asustan será pa' mejor. Es el pueblo entero el que ya está gritando, ¡viva la revolución!
Iranian nuclear weapons development.
They have turned the island into a communist hellhole.
The experiment in Venezuela has failed completely.
La bestialidad imperialista. Bestialidad que no tiene una frontera determinada ni pertenece a un país determinado. Bestias fueron las hordas hitleristas, como bestias son los norteamericanos hoy, como bestias son los paracaidistas belgas, como bestias fueron los imperialistas franceses en Argelia. Porque es la naturaleza del imperialismo la que bestializa a los hombres, la que la convierte en fieras sedientas de sangre que están dispuestas a degollar, a asesinar, a destruir hasta la última imagen de un revolucionario, de un partidario de un régimen que haya caído bajo su bota o que luche por su libertad. Y la estatua que recuerda a Lumumba, hoy destruida pero mañana reconstruida, nos recuerda también en la historia trágica de ese mártir de la revolución del mundo, que no se puede confiar en el imperialismo, pero ni tantito así, nada.
This reminds me of September 1st, 1939, when Hitler invaded Poland. And remember, in the 30s, lots of Americans said, why do we care about Czechoslovakia? Where is Poland? This is not our war. This is not our problem. That's what they said.
If the Russians launch a more massive cyber attack and, for example, try to shut down all the power in Ukraine, you can't control once you unleash cyber weapons malware by geographic locations. That cyber attack could bleed into eastern Poland, where there are American troops, or it could shut down a Polish hospital.
Well, we need strength and we need resolve. The reason that Russia has invaded Ukraine is because of catastrophic mistakes made by President Biden and Vice President Harris. There are two causes in particular that put us in this situation. Number one, last year, when we withdrew from Afghanistan, the absolutely catastrophic withdrawal, incompetently executed, every enemy of America across the globe looked at America and was emboldened. They looked at the Oval Office and they took a measure of the man in the Oval Office. And unfortunately, they concluded that the president was weak and feckless and ineffective. And as I said at the time, the chances of a Russian invasion of Ukraine have just increased tenfold. And also, every bit as troubling, the chances of a Chinese invasion of Taiwan have increased tenfold.
So the people of Russia today are remarkably ill-served by their increasingly isolated, aging dictator who has over 20 years in power under his belt already. He's got plans for 20 more. He has no plan for a successor and apparently no plan to release Russia from the suffocating hold that he has on that beleaguered country in the face of its 144 million people.
Russian troops have entered the northern district of the Ukrainian capital of Kyiv in what is seen as part of a move to encircle the city and topple the Ukrainian government.
We are under a spell. We are being duped into war. The wizards of Wall Street, the wizards of CNN, MSNBC, Fox are trying to convince us into war with Russia. We're not falling for it. We're not falling for all their BS. We know about Afghanistan. We know what happened in Iraq. We know what happened in Libya. And We're not going to fall for it. We're not going to be duped into war with Russia. What's up, everybody? Welcome to episode 65, Unmasking Imperialism, Exposing Imperialist Propaganda in Mainstream Media. And today we're going to do some additional coverage of mainstream media nonsense on Russia-Ukraine, manufacturing consent for war against Russia. And we're going to talk about how mainstream media outlets are parroting the talking points of Wall Street and Washington, how many on the left, including a lot of white liberal, quote unquote, leftists who say they're progressive, say they're against violence and war, are just pushing and egging on for war against Russia and sanctions. People like AOC and the squad saying that sanctions are a good thing, that we need to crack down on Russians. And we're going to talk about, most importantly, how and why this imperialist war is interconnected with the war on Black, brown, and colonized working class communities in the imperial core at home. We just saw that Biden's administration granted like over $200 million to Ukraine, all these billions of dollars being funneled into wars and weapons. Meanwhile, here in LA, here in all over the US, you see homelessness rising, Black and brown peoples being kicked out of their houses. So the war on Black, brown, working class people continues, but they're so focused on saving the poor, innocent Ukrainians from big, bad Putin. So we're going to talk about all that. Joining me today is a comrade I've been wanting to have on for a while, somebody who I have a lot of respect for, who does amazing work decolonizing the mind, spitting truth, Dr. Jared A. Ball, Professor of Communications and Africana Studies at Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland. Jared is the author of The Myth and Propaganda of Black Buying Power, an amazing book. And Jared is also the host of the podcast, I Mix What I Like, and co-founder of Black Power Media. Please like and subscribe to Black Power Media, an amazing channel. They have a lot of really great content that you can listen to throughout the day with a lot of different people, which can be found at blackpowermedia.org. Jared's decades of journalism, media writing, and political work can be found at imixwhatilike.org. Link is in the description. Please visit his website. Please subscribe to Black Power Media, an amazing channel. How's it going, comrade Jared?
It's as good as could be expected, and I am really, really, really excited and honored to be on your platform. I've become a big fan over the last few months. I really appreciate the work you're doing, and I really so I appreciate, you know, being invited to be part of this discussion, but really I'm seeing myself as sort of co-hosting and then as we're, you know, we've talked about, we're going to collaborate on a sort of a cross branding discussion and interview later on that will also air on our platform as well. And I definitely have wanted to build with you, so I really appreciate this and everything as it relates to this specific topic at hand. I mean, seriously, everything that I would have learned to say over the last couple of weeks would have come from your platform. The incredible discussion you all just had the other day, the one also on our platform with Ajamu Baraka and Daruba Bin Wahad, several others. But really, in particular, I've learned a lot over here lately. So anyway, it's an honor to be here and I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Yeah, shout out to Ajamu Baraka, shout out to Black Alliance for Peace, to Comrade Erica Keynes, to Comrade Salifu. So many amazing Absolutely. People. I think people are waking up to the nonsense of the Democratic Party, because a lot of times the liberals, the Democrats, they try to win over Black and brown communities, and they try their hardest to bring our peoples back into empire. And they try so hard to try to put peoples in positions of power at the helm of empire to create a sort of intersectional imperialism. And I think that the majority of people, like here in LA, I talk to a lot of working class Latinos, and also New York, where I'm from, I'm born and raised in New York, just talking to people out in Queens and Jamaica, where I'm from, Jamaica, Queens, like people are not vibing with the whole squad, the whole representation, a seat at the table. They know it's nonsense. And I think that that's what your channel, your work, and so many others are also Black Agenda Report, Hood Communist, mm-hmm. all these amazing outlets that are springing up, that are organic, that are resisting this attempt to co-opt Black, brown colonized communities into imperialism and to reconnect with the revolutionary movements of our class, our peoples around the world. And I think it's something that's very beautiful. But, you know, talking about what's going on now, obviously the main topic and the main thing that's happening right now has been the Russia-Ukraine situation. I don't like to call it a war or a conflict because a lot of times it puts it on an equal footing. What has happened, just to give everybody a recap, if you want to check out what has happened, I would suggest checking out the previous stream I did on Donbass. So basically, there's this region in quote-unquote eastern Ukraine, Donbass, which comprises of two provinces, Donetsk and Luhansk, which historically for hundreds of years have been part of Russia. Over 90% of the community there are Russian, right? It'd be like saying, I'm in LA right now. I'm talking to you from LA, Southern California. I'm in a neighborhood that's like 95% Mexican. That was Mexican land. And the U.S. eventually colonized it. So this is technically part of Mexico. This is like ethnically part of Mexico, but it's technically under the jurisdiction of the U.S. So it's a very similar situation. And what has happened is that for the past 8 years, since the 2014 Western-backed imperialist coup in Ukraine, the Euromaidan, a hipster imperialist rebellion, so to speak, similar to what they did in Libya against Gaddafi, the same methods, same tactics, pro-democracy protesters, the artists in the street dancing and confronting the soldiers. You know, since that 2014 coup, a fascist government has come into power in Ukraine, aligned with NATO, aligned with the European Union. And what has happened is that for many years after World War II, after the Soviet Union, the communists defeated the Nazis in Germany, the Soviet Union and the European Union came to an agreement where they said, look, we're not going to expand more into Ukraine or Belarus or these other places, but just don't build NATO more east. Because if you build military functions and developments in Eastern Europe, you're going to try to attack and take over Russia, which has been done over and over. And so the European Union and NATO has not only violated that, they've been pushing for Ukraine to enter NATO. The fascist Ukrainian government, which has openly used swastikas, have openly used Confederate flags, they have been murdering ethnic Russians, and not only ethnic Russians, other minorities in Ukraine. They have been banning communist parties, banning leftists. If you have even a hammer and sickle or anything like that, you're killed. They have surrounded those provinces, and the people of those provinces who are Russian have asked for help, Going back to the comparison of LA, imagine if hypothetically under Trump, the Trump military, the Ukrainian military came and surrounded LA and was murdering Mexicans, and Mexicans in LA hit up Mexico and was like, yo, we need help. Like, can you help us out? So that's what happened. You know, Putin sent in a peacekeeping force to Donetsk and Lugansk to confront the fascists. Obviously, the Ukrainian military and the fascists are not going to let that slide. So there has been gun battle. And so basically what has happened, just to kind of to cap it off, is that Ukraine and NATO and the Western powers for eight years have murdered, encircled and killed Russians, ethnic Russians in Ukraine. Russia was finally like, we need to go in there and get them out. And now it's a Russian invasion. Now Russia's a boogeyman. Now they're using this to manufacture consent against war. The sanctions have already been imposed on Russia. That's going to hurt people in Russia and in the U.S., by the way. That's going to hurt poor working class people in the U.S. I don't know about you guys, but my gas prices have been freaking soaring.
Oh yeah,
these past few weeks, you know. So I don't know, Comrade Jared, you know, I've already said enough, but what are your thoughts or reactions to what's been going on, and how is this going to impact working class Black and brown communities in the U.S.? Why should we give a fuck, basically?
Well, I mean, the first thing I thought of, in addition to, again, and everybody should go back and watch that stream that you just did the other day, should go watch Ajamu and Daruba chop it up. They should go watch the Breakthrough News joint that Rania Kotlik and Eugene Puryear did the other day. I mean, all of this has to be, you know, folded into context. But the first thing I thought of, as is usually the first thing I think of, is what Dr. King said about Vietnam, that the bombs you drop overseas explode at home. So it's and particularly for those of us who do start our own analysis at home with one that begins in domestic or semi or internal colonialism, we see that what's happening here is part of a colonial process. So that is extended abroad with U.S. imperialism that would, of course, want to influence and encourage just something that, like what we're seeing here, that will allow for them to not only generate and marshal resources away from taking care of the internal contradictions and conditions, and actually use this as an outlet, both materially and immaterially, to say, don't focus here at home. You know, I was on another channel that I watch that focuses a lot on scams, like crypto and other scams. This guy has caught apparently an adult film star recently in an NFT scam, and in calling her out online, she literally said, as part of her response to him, you know, in a public tweet, you know, why are you bothering me about NFT scams and me running off with everybody's millions of dollars when there's a war in Ukraine? You know, and I thought of that, and I was like, wait a minute. So everybody's just going to jump in now? Like, you know, so 5 minutes ago, nobody even knows what's going on, knows this place exists. Now it's going to be used, again, materially and immaterially to be an outlet for little things like that. And of course, big things like the fact that we don't have healthcare, jobs, peace, education, bridges that work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that was the first thing I thought, and that I think is pretty apparent is already taking place. I did also think, especially hearing, I think I hope I'm pronouncing his name right, Chris Duran on your show, yeah. Right? Because I only know of him online. But he said, he in talking about his own personal story, it actually, you know. I technically have my own sort of personal, you know, my mother's father was born in Minsk.
Oh, wow.
And though I never, you know, we never knew each other. And interestingly enough, he also published poetry in Black magazines and journals. So that was this European Jew publishing poetry and, but anyway, so that was just a little interest.
That's pretty cool.
Side note for me, but it also is. But I was just the other personal thing, just very quickly, is that it also reminded me of what I don't see and what I see this being used against already, as it's targeted towards young people, particularly in the media and discussions. That is, when I was growing up, admittedly, my household was very uncommon, and although I didn't realize it so much at the time, it was kind of like what Ajamu said in his discussion the other day. There was this automatic, if the U.S. likes it, you know, we're probably against it.
Yeah.
And if the U.S. is complaining, we're probably jumping in all, you know, and in our household in particular, there was this very pro-Soviet, pro-Russian, pro-communist worldview, admittedly, but I don't know, not that I would expect that level of solidarity to exist, you know, overall too much today, but there's almost no room for, I mean, I'm listening to even my daughters coming back from the discussion in their schools. And admittedly, we would expect a certain narrow and limited nature to the discussion, but they're all, I mean, they're just coming back, and fortunately we've been able to, you know, prepare for this a little bit, but they're coming back. I mean, all of the discussion is just as we would expect. It is automatic that Russia bad, Ukraine good, U.S. needs support, send hundreds of millions of dollars. And when you ask why, a music program is being shut down, or a theater program is being shut down, or students don't have enough books, you know, let's not worry too much about that. And especially now that there's a war in Ukraine, you know, that kind of thing. So, I mean, it's anyway, so, forgive the sort of,
worries.
My thoughts, but those are just some of the thoughts I was thinking, like, and we have to, I think really, you know, I mean, all of us doing the kind of work that we're all doing in our various ways, we do have to find ways to magnify that work, to extend. I mean, even in your intro, And even in the intro you gave yesterday after your edited piece, where you came right in with the automatically just out the break, solidarity with Russia, no to war. This is, you know, however you phrased it, much better than I'm doing now. But the point is, we don't even hear any kind of even mild critique, nothing, much less a very stern, you know, less we have to stand up to the nonsense. So
Yeah, no, definitely. And I think there's also a lot of cowardice, too, because there's a lot of people on the quote unquote left who they know this is being used. Like, they've seen it, right? We remember Iraq. We remember Syria, Libya, Afghanistan. And what happens is that whenever shit like this happens, like right now, we're in the heat of the Ukraine-Russia thing, right? We're in the heat of it. So taking any position that is remotely in solidarity with Russia or with anti-fascists or with people against empire, you're like, oh my God, you're Putin's agent. You're a stooge for Putin. And you're going to take a lot of hits. I've taken hits. Like, people I know who have defended Russia and anti-fascism have taken hits. And that's now. That's fine. But a few months down the line, once the U.S. is already ramping up its retaliation against Russia, then all the people who are like, oh, well, both sides are bad. You know, both sides we have to consider. Those people are going to be like, oh, from the beginning, I was always in solidarity with Russia. And it's just crazy to me because I remember seeing that happen. I think a big eye opener for me in 2011 was the overthrow, the coup, the violent, horrible coup against Gaddafi in Libya. And I remember I was living in New York at the time. And it's just crazy because among the sort of quote unquote progressive leftist soy latte circles in Manhattan, they were all against Gaddafi. They were like, I support the Libyan revolution against this brutal tyrant Gaddafi who's forcing people to rape women and he's horrible. And this, and when I would go back, because I was living in Queens at the time, to Jamaica, Queens, I don't know if you've been out there before, very working class black and brown community. And I would talk to everyday people who never went to college, who never went to these fancy schools. They were more politically advanced. They were like, yo, it's bullshit. They're trying to take over Africa. Gaddafi wanted to unite Africa, introduce the African currency. They don't want somebody like him, so they're taking him out. And like, it's just, that was a big eye-opener for me to see that when you have these entrenched liberal, quote-unquote, leftist peoples who are in these academic circles or in these media circles, they're scared. They're too cowardly to defend a nation that's unpopular to defend, right? It's not cozy or trendy to defend the DPRK, aka North Korea or Cuba or Venezuela. You know, you're not going to get some high position of power with that. And I think that that's why we see a lot of people doing this sort of either or. So it's just really interesting to see that. But what I want to do, Jared, I want to play a clip. This is a clip of Maxine Waters, everybody's favorite. She calls herself Auntie Maxie, right? Really horrible. But anyway, she's been one of the people who, within the Democratic Party, has been one of the most vocal, Russophobic, anti-Russia, you know, let's go and invade Russia. She's been talking about this for years. So I want to play this clip, and then I want to talk about one of the terms that the late, great Glenn Ford, you know, rest in peace, Glenn Ford, talked about. The black misleadership class and how the Democrats are trying to use more figures like this to lead people into war.
Can't people see what's going on? Why do you think they hacked into our election? They hacked into the election because they have to make sure that Donald Trump got elected so that he could help them with what I think is a huge deal, not only to lift these sanctions, but to take over, you know, all of these Soviet countries and pull them back into the Soviet Union so that they could have access to all of these resources. It's clear to me. And I just think the American people had better understand what's going on. This is a bunch of scumbags. That's what they are.
Those are very strong words, Congressman.
Organized around making money.
Who do you mean by that when you call them scumbags? Who are you talking to?
All of these people who are organized with these oil and gas interests that's in the administration and friends of the President of the United States, this back channeling that you see, these are a bunch of scumbags.
Secretary of State, you mean the Secretary of State of the United States?
Well, I tell you this, Tillerson is there to get these sanctions lifted. I believe it. Just watch him. He's going to continue to work on it. This is important for him. He was there because he negotiated the deal for Exxon with Putin.
There you have the lovable Auntie Maxine pushing for sanctions, pushing for sanctions that not only hurt the governments, but they hurt the working class people, the poorest people. Sanctions in Zimbabwe, in Venezuela, Cuba, all hurt Black and brown families, and they hurt everybody. So, you know, your analysis of this, Comrade Jared, like your thoughts on Auntie Maxine and all of that.
So I was trying to write down just some things just so I don't forget everything, because there's a lot. So first of all, we have to remember, it's those of us of a certain age will appreciate that Maxine Waters has been playing, hustling for a long time, where she will do certain things that are symbolically very community Black. Like she'll do the like she'll come to, she'll do the cookout, she'll do the you know, and in particular I'm thinking of she'll host the panel back in the day where evidence was being brought to the public about the CIA's involvement in bringing crack cocaine into LA. You know, she'll sit on those panels and convene those discussions. She will as she did some years ago, where some of us will remember when we were when I was working with WPFW and the Decipher Hip Hop Block some years ago, we'll remember that she brought in leading hip hop artists like Snoop to have a summit and discussion about, I don't know, the art and the politics or whatever. And when we reached out to her office to politely invite her to include locally based grassroots, truly politicized rap artists and hip hop artists, broadly speaking, there was no interest. It's very symbolic. She could do the performance, and then when it comes to issues like these that are a little more nuanced, and frankly, where most of us just don't know what's going on with Ukraine and Russia and things like, she can come out and take certain stances and positions, and she'll automatically have cachet among a lot of Black people, as is the case with many who are in the Congressional Black Caucus. So, Glenn and Bruce, and for a time, Sister Letitia Stills, led what I thought was one of my favorite of their projects, which was the CBC report card, which is something we should probably bring back, where based on our set of criteria, they would be judged and given a grade, and then we would even have award ceremonies and shows. Like that was like actually part of the, you know, anyway. So and in all these cases, it was something that more is, I don't know, a very quick and I think powerful way of letting people know, like, these folks are not on our team. They're not, you know, and I definitely remember the time when Cynthia McKinney was in office hosting events around COINTELPRO and whatever. Maxine and the rest of the CBC would literally put McKinney and her conferences in like the corner, in the corner rooms, in the smaller rooms, and have no, you know, support or anything like that. So to see her playing that same role now is, you know, and by the way, I gave you credit for something that I did, because I was biting off of you the other day, and I wanted to remind you, because of this, the importance of collective viewing. Yeah. Like, because I was in your chat a couple weeks ago when you were playing these clips, and I was like, I can't imagine watching this by myself. Like, I can't do it. Like, I have a hard time watching. So I can only watch it in these kinds of settings. So I appreciate that. Wanted to give you so as I'm watching that just right there, there's like, you know, I don't mean to be disrespectful to the term, but like, it's somewhat traumatic. It's like, man, they're just lying and they get away with it. And for her to sit there to talk about a scheme to make money while she sits in Congress, making however many zeros she's been making on and off the books for how many years. Anyway, whatever, you know.
And now here's
you
the
see
city
in your
that,
own city, you see how bad it is.
It's crazy because she supports sanctions. She supports war. She supports all this money for NATO and for Ukraine. Meanwhile, literally blocks away from me. Like, she represents the area not too far from me out here in L.A., tents as far as I can see, homelessness, mainly Black and brown people who can't even afford to eat, people who can't afford proper clothing or anything. And she's talking about sending money and attacking somebody halfway across the world. So it's just crazy to me. And I think it's just frustrating because then when it comes time for elections here, they're like, we need to support the Democrats, all in for blue. And, you know, we need to fight hate here. And it's like, what about the crazy, shady shit that you guys are doing internationally? Like, nobody ever wants to bring that up. And when you bring it up, like, you just sound, you feel like a crazy person because, you know, as that's why I played that clip in the beginning of Nina, the great Nina Simone, I Put a Spell on You. It's like, I feel like right now, like, everybody is in a mass hysteria, mass spell, mass psychosis, where they're trying to bring us into war, into this humanitarian lens. And that is the new face of empire. And what I want to do, there's another
can I just say,
I want to play. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Just very quickly before I forget, because we have to remember this, that this society in terms of the spell has also been induced into it in part because of a so-called liberal or left support for the nonsense of Russiagate preceding all of this for what, a decade or half a decade or whatever, telling people that Russia is the reason you suffered with Trump. Russia is the reason why you didn't get your Hillary Clinton. Russia is the reason why whatever is going on. And as we've talked about, you know, there is a direct link between that narrative and through intelligence agencies and other entities that comes right into literally into the scripts of everybody's favorite TV shows and series, where the very language of useful idiots, et cetera, is brought right on in. So by the time now, it's so easy. Everybody's been primed for Russia bad, Ukraine good. Anyway, sorry about that. Go ahead.
No, no worries. And even it's just interesting. Like, let's look at Barbara Lee, her Twitter. One tweet, she's like, in a modern moral society, housing is a human right. Proud to join this bill to address affordable housing shortage and support proven community-driven solutions to homelessness. Right? We can agree on that, right? We want more homes for homeless folks, housing for all. And then literally the next tweet over, she's like, President Zelensky, your bravery and patriotism have inspired the world. Praying for him and all Ukrainians fighting, fleeing, and worried about their livelihood, or saying goodbye to loved ones. Stand with Ukraine. And we know stand with Ukraine means arm Ukraine, which means arm fascists and take away money from the homeless people you claim to like and claim to support to send to fascists to kill more oppressed communities in the other side of the world. So just the hypocrisy is crazy. And what I want to do, this is a clip from the ambassador, Linda Thomas Greenfield, at the UN Security Council emergency meeting on Ukraine just a few days ago. Somebody who was heralded, right? When she was elected to her position by the Biden administration, everybody was like, finally, a seat at the table, representation, and we'll have, you know, more equality. And it's just crazy to see that. So this is her remarks, and we'll talk a little bit more about that.
Thank you, Mr. President. And thank you, Secretary General. Thank you for your strong stance and your powerful remarks today at the General Assembly and for your remarks tonight. Colleagues, a few moments ago, I spoke to President Biden, who asked me to convey in the strongest possible terms his and our steadfast support for Ukraine and support for the urgent meeting this council has convened tonight. Furthermore, he asked me to share that the United States and our allies and partners will continue to respond to Russia's actions with unity, with clarity, and with conviction. We are here tonight because we believe, along with Ukraine, that a full-scale further invasion into Ukraine by Russia is imminent. Tonight, we're seeing the Russians close airspace, move troops into Donbas, and move forces into combat-ready positions. This is a perilous moment, and we're here for one reason and one reason only, to ask Russia to stop, return to your borders, send your troops and your tanks and your planes back to their barracks and hangars, and send your diplomats to the negotiating table. Back away from the brink before it is too late. Last week, the United States informed this council and the world about what we expected to see unfold. We said that Russia would manufacture a pretext for an attack. We have since seen numerous false flag events staged along the lines of contact in Donbas. We said Russia would theatrically convene emergency meetings at the highest levels of the Russian government. We all saw this on Monday with the state televised Security Council meeting held by President Putin, an orchestrated moment in which the Russian government decided to recognize as, and I quote, independent states, unquote, sovereign territory of Ukraine controlled by Russia's proxies since 2014.
By the way, shout out to Erica. She said, you know, she didn't write a single line of this. There was probably some old white imperialist dude who's like, we got to get our diversity higher to read the script. And, you know, we got to sell this war, man. We got to sell this. I could just imagine.
I don't even think she read it one time before she got. I think she was handed that as she was sitting down. Yeah. I mean, she didn't even look like she had read it before, much less write it.
So yeah. They're like, Linda, we got to read this. We got to make sure you recruit those Black and Latino folks into supporting this war.
Now, I'm bad with this because I come from a family of credit hounds, and I do have to say that I called this when Biden appointed her and Blinken. We went through her work record, and Blinken was already saying. Right in line with the narrative you've shown that they've unfolded here today or this week about Putin being Hitler, Blinken said out the gate that his experience as a Jew was and his family and his family's history or in his people's history coming out of Nazi Germany meant that he was full-fledged in wanting to spread American democracy to make sure there wouldn't be a rise of another Hitler. So of course that means spread imperialism, and Greenfield, her whole history is making foreign governments accept US foreign policy and businesses accept adopt US foreign policy interests. Like that was her whole, I don't remember the details, but that was her whole business. So she would even have a history of having somebody give her a script to carry over and read in preparation to further the efforts of her bosses. But that's wild.
Yeah, and by the way, these are the people that she's defending. Like, what right we're looking on. At an image of the Ukrainian fascist military division called the Azov Battalion. Right, these are the people that you liberals out there are defending. These are them. Right, you have in the back the NATO flag, the flag of Nazi Germany with the swastika, and the flag of the Azov Battalion. They're doing the Heil Hitler sign. They have their U.S. guns paid for by the U.S. taxpayer. Right, that money should be going to building houses and healthcare and education. Arming fat. This is what these liberal imperialist people are supporting, right? And this is why it's important to reclaim the revolutionary socialism of the real heroes from Asia, Africa, Latin America, Amilcar Cabral, you know, Gaddafi, you know, Thomas Sankara, Che Guevara. Like, those are real leftists. Those are real revolutionaries who fought against empire, not these fake woke intersectional imperialists figureheads and diversity hires at Washington, and this is who they support, right?
To your point about the Democratic Party, this is them. This is the international version of the lesser of two evils that they have prepared this country's voting body for. So Putin is, I mean, that's clearly bad, but Putin is worse. Right. So we have to, if we have to live with a couple of Nazis, it's better than a Russian so-called imperialist, which, by the way, has been funny to watch a little bit. I have to admit, in my pettiness, some of the white left debate this week, as there has been some debate over people calling this the Battle of Two Imperialisms. And there, you know, so I even saw Glenn Greenwald pushing back and saying, no, what the U.S. did in Iraq was worse and this, that, which he was right. But it was just weird that he had to go. So to your, I think you made the point earlier, the certainly the mainstream, the psychological warfare apparatus of the ruling elite is going to do what it's doing, but the so-called alternative liberal left is even falling apart. Like there, so watching them argue with each other has been kind of funny a little bit. I have to admit that.
Yeah, no, it is. And it's revealing. It shows the contradiction between what is the real left and what is the fake synthetic white liberal left. I think for me, honestly, I have to go back to Libya. Like that was such a turning point, man, because like I remember this was just around the time of Occupy Wall Street, like a little bit after. And everybody, a lot of these outlets, Jacobin, and back then it was called the ISO, and a lot of white Trotskyist Euro left organizations, they made a lot of money. It was their hustle, that like from Occupy. And then what happened is that like once Libya happened, once Gaddafi was murdered, they were like, we support the pro-democracy protesters in Libya. And like it ended up being that black revolutionary groups from the hoods of New York and Brooklyn and the Bronx that I came to meet, and we would go to the protests in the Libyan after the coup outside the Libyan consulate in Manhattan. And it was such an eye opener, because that was like the real people, the real anti-imperialists, and these sort of cafe latte leftists, they supported the empire, they supported the talking points. And it just showed, like, it revealed to me the real class difference between even among the quote-unquote left, you know, the people who get paid to promote imperialism with the left face, and the real people of the working class communities who have a good instinct. So I think something similar is happening now, where you have people who are not even politicized, people in working class neighborhoods. They don't want war with Russia, right? They want money for jobs and education. One thing I always say is money for jobs and education, not wars and occupation. And that's something that people resoundingly support in the working class neighborhoods. But it tends to be in academia and media where these quote unquote leftists support imperialism and intervention. And unfortunately, that includes a lot of tokens and diversity hires for imperialism, like AOC, like, you know, a lot of times Ilhan Omar, a lot of times Ayanna Pressley, The Squad, Barbara Lee, you know, Maxine Waters, all these people who are upheld. And then let me not even get started on people like Thomas Sowell. We should probably do an episode in the future on Thomas Sowell. That would be kind of interesting. But there's also
so I actually have subscribed to Sowell's a YouTube channel that produces his analysis, but I can't. So we would have to do that in collaboration collectively, because I honestly can't stand. I mean, the stress level that I feel sitting by myself watching it, the anger, it's much easier for me to stay calm and keep it light and funny when I'm in public or with comrades, because by myself, man, I honestly get too angry. It's not good for me health-wise, not good for my family, not the vibe in the household, because it's infuriating, because I know they know better. And I know in certain cases like Sowell and others, I believe in my heart that they know better and are doing this to get a check. And this goes to some of the points you've already made, that there is people know, and the politicians even that purport to be on the left know. This was my biggest problem with Sanders, when everybody was saying, but at least he's putting socialism out there for a topic of conversation. Right. My thing was, he's representing it so poorly that it's not going to stick. It's going to be an anti-brand in a minute, in part because of his foreign policy. So it's the same thing. You can't sit here and talk all this good talk about healthcare and peace and jobs when you're talking about, at the same breath, you're supporting all of the militarist actions overseas, if not most of them. And you're certainly not making enough of the argument about redirecting those energies and resources elsewhere, because they know that that's how you lose your job, if not more. And that and that's it. So it's fine to run around. And that's, again, every one of the so-called greats, whether they were leaders or organizations that connected the internal colonization and domestic abuse to international struggles, they're the ones that get targeted more than anybody. And politicians to this day know it, whether it's, you know, Sanders, AOC, or whoever, Omar, whoever. And it's frustrating. It's crazy.
Most definitely. Yeah. Most definitely. Comrade Jared, just kind of switching gears here, because I know we wanted to incorporate a conversation where you can ask me a few questions. What did you have in mind? What, you know, what do you want to know? I'll tell you my social security number. I'll tell you, not playing. I'll tell you certain like things. But yeah, you know, it's been, I've followed your work for quite some time, and you have a lot of great content. And you're somebody who I respect because you're also not afraid to take positions that are unpopular and not commodified in academia and not commodified in media. And I know it's hard to do because when you take an anti-imperialist line on certain positions, you're not going to get a lot of opportunities in Babylon, as I like to call it, or empire. But I respect your principles and I respect the media work that you do, and also your humility as well, because when you're creating content, you're having conversations, you approach it from a position of like, you know, I'm still learning this. I don't know all the answers, but let's learn it together, which I think gives it a very clean and human face to it, which is very like, which is very appreciated. You know, it's not like, oh, you know, you need to learn this and that. So I really like that about your content. But, you know, what do you, what would you like to know?
So I appreciate that. I mean, yeah, I don't want to take up the time. There's some nuance I would like to get into another time worries. About that.
No, feel free to ask whatever you want. Yeah.
No. I was thinking about in terms of how you were very pleasantly describing me. I think I appreciate it, but I think there are some flaws that I'm still working on as well. So, you know, I've said, you know, in a positive way, I mean this, that some of my own public engagement is performative in the sense that I am trying to represent a certain politics and principle and ethic that sometimes I don't always live up to in every minute, publicly or privately. So, and sometimes, speaking just what I was just saying, sometimes I am more quick-tempered and less humble offline or off air than I should be, and I have been historically. So, but the other thing is, and I've got this, I think, from Ward Churchill, and this is exactly my experience. You go to undergrad and you think you know everything. You go to graduate school, you realize you know nothing, and then you get a PhD and you realize nobody knows anything. So on some level, that process is humbling. And then I do come at this as an activist, which is itself humbling because there's really no other way to approach to experience activism without being humbled and having and all that. So all that to say, what I've really wanted to talk with you about is among other things, the broader perspective that I see you bringing to your platform that I am selfishly at least ignorant of, too ignorant of. That is particularly Latin American perspectives, and then some of that, again, the real left in combination with each other. So even just your edited intro is incredibly powerful and amazing. So I just wanted to hear maybe a little bit more about how you got there, because the Latin American family I married into, admittedly, are wonderful, perfect, incredible human beings, but those politics are not there. So so my experience with Latin America is much different than Black America and doesn't have that radical. So when I hear from you,
yeah,
I'm like, dude, that's what I want to learn more about. So
if you don't mind me asking, what country are they from?
Panama. So I meant to add, when you even were talking about all the invasions.
Yeah,
interesting. You know, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, so like, anyway, you know.
That's very interesting. Yeah, with Panama, I mean, Panama, just to quickly give some anecdotes, Panama in many ways was kind of artificially created in the early 1900s, separated from Colombia. And the imperialists have always wanted to maintain Panama. Today, it functions as a fiscal paradise for bankers, for the crypto colonizers, mm-hmm. as we call them, similar to Puerto Rico and how they're trying to do with El Salvador with Bitcoin. And unfortunately, in Latin America and the Caribbean, I think one of the things that people have to recognize is that Latino is not a race. There are different races in Latin America and the Caribbean. There are, like, if you ever meet a white Panamanian, they're fucking reactionary as fuck a lot of times. Not all. I've met some cool ones, but the majority of the population is Black, right? And there's also indigenous peoples. But the racial nature of the racial question, the national question in Latin America is so important to understand. And I think a lot of people in the Western left don't really understand that because it's central to the class struggle in Latin America and the Caribbean. The people who descended from the Spaniards, who are the peninsulares, referring to the Iberian Peninsula, or the criollos, the Creoles, they tend to be wealthier. They tend to be in finance capital in the cities. Black indigenous peoples tend to be the working class in the agriculture industry in the urban areas as well. And the national question in Latin America is so important to understand. And even within the region, like the fact that Haiti, unfortunately, this is my critique of the Latin American left, that Haiti does not get as much love and support from the Latin American left as it should, even though Haiti, you know, is the mother of revolution in Nuestra America, that we call it in our America. It's really a shame. So I think for just to go back to your question, you know, my family is from Honduras, which is in Central America. And Honduras is neighbors Nicaragua, right? Honduras has always been sort of kind of the way that Colombia has been in South America, used as a base of reaction against revolutionary movements. During the 80s, when you had revolutions in Guatemala, El Salvador, and Nicaragua, led by indigenous peoples, by Marxists, by communists, the School of the Americas and USAID and Israel and Taiwan and Chile under Pinochet, they trained the Honduran military to train the Contras to basically attack all of these leftist uprisings in the area. So my family is very right wing. I know exactly what you're talking about when you're saying like the politics. All my family is right wing. Like my cousin married the former general of the Honduran military. His name is Arnulfo Cantarero. If you look him up, he was somebody who was the general of the Honduran military, studied the U.S. I went to his house one time because I was visiting family in Honduras, and he had a plaque that says School of the Americas. And I was like, oh, you know, I'm a communist, right? I was like, I don't fuck with that. And he was like, oh, you silly, like just hit the way he talked about it. He's like, oh, you're just a silly communist. You'll grow out of it when you get older. You know, just the kind of arrogance, right? And so whatever, my whole family is right-wing and very reactionary. And basically, one of the things that radicalized me, especially, was several moments. I think one of them was 9/11, seeing the racism that happened after. Like, I grew up in New York, and I was in school, and there was a new student from India who came in, and he was Punjabi. Oh, he was Sikh. He had a turban. And what happened is that after 9/11 happened, these kids were fucking him up. And I was like, damn, like just seeing how the spell, right, going back to this whole theme, like how people get duped and psychologically controlled with these imperialist spells, where like you have Black and brown kids from the hood beating up an Indian kid just because in mainstream media, they're saying anybody with a turban is a terrorist. Right. And so that awoke in me the 2003 invasion of Iraq. Eventually in 2009, there was a U.S.-backed military coup against Manuel Zelaya, who was the first leftist president of Honduras, you know, where my family's from. And that immediately, like, wow, that was crazy, because you had a president dragged out in his pajamas, flown to the jungle of Costa Rica, left there. And after that, we had 12 years of neoliberalism, of narco violence in Honduras. The former Honduran president, Juan Orlando Hernandez, was just recently arrested. He was financed by El Chapo Guzman in Mexico, one of the biggest drug lords of Sinaloa cartel. So basically, Honduras has been a right-wing narco state for 12 years under capitalism. And just seeing that, seeing how the free market and all this bullshit that they say, that privatize everything, the free market is best, the best government is no government, as Thomas Sowell says, right? That kind of stuff. And just seeing that play out, seeing that not work, seeing the chaos, seeing kids starving in the street. Like, I remember seeing kids, a girl that had just one arm, because she lost the other one. She was like almost naked. She had a full stomach because of, she had like worms, eating through dumpsters. Like, just seeing shit like that, I was like, damn. And then seeing the invasion of Libya, right? How somebody as dignified and strong as Gaddafi was humiliated, right? Was murdered. and then seeing the images of enslaved Black Libyans being fucking sold, like just the craziness of that, right? And then at that point, that's when I realized the evolution of imperialism, how now it takes this woke hipster appearance. And then after that, continuing, you know, just to see all these cool attempts in Syria, in Venezuela, in Nicaragua, so many other places. And so there's been a lot of events. I also went to Bangladesh in 2014, and I got to meet some really dope communists out there. I got to see some of the factories, the sweatshops where clothes are produced. And growing up in New York, I had a lot of friends from Bangladesh. And it was interesting because there was an H&M store where one of my friends worked at. He's from Bangladesh. And the shirts, the tags, it'll say made in Bangladesh, right? So here you had a poor urban immigrant Bengali person forced to sell their labor at H&M in New York in the empire. And then I went to Bangladesh. I saw the H&M sweatshop conditions myself, and seeing how horrible it is probably his family. It could have been anybody in his family working there. And you see full circle how imperialism connects, like, the super exploitation of workers in the global South, in Asia, Africa, Latin America, and also the super exploitation of Black, brown colonized peoples in the heart of empire. And just seeing that, I was like, holy shit, like, there's this huge system called capitalism, called imperialism, and all of these problems in society can be attributed to that, because we're always fed, and going back to Thomas Sowell, this dogma of, like, pull yourself up by the bootstraps. If you're hurting, it's your fault. It's your choice. There's no systemic issues. It's all about your individual choices. And just seeing how capitalism was interconnected to all of these different things just awakened my class consciousness. And so I'm thankful to be able to have had those experiences, and really amazing people like Glenn Ford, really amazing people who have taught me about real revolutionaries throughout history. Then I started learning about Angola and the MPLA. I started learning about Mozambique and Zimbabwe and ZANU-PF. And I started learning about Kim Il-sung. I started learning about Fidel Castro and the Sandinistas. And it's just from there, just seeing like, wow, all of these amazing revolutionaries fighting against the system that I discovered how evil and horrible it is. They all were interconnected, right? Like African Cubans went to Africa to fight alongside their ancestors, their sisters and brothers against this settler colonial empire. You know, people in Vietnam, the Black Panthers are going to the DPRK to work with the Workers' Party of Korea and Kim Il-sung. You know, you had all these interconnections. And when I discovered that, I was like, wow, that's so beautiful. Like the spirit of internationalism really awoken within me. And I think that's something that continues to inspire to me today. That's why I tell people, leave the U.S., go to other countries, especially in particular the global South, and just meet communists in other countries. And I promise you, you will come back with so much energy and devotion and passion to exposing empire, exposing capitalism, because they're bearing the brunt of it, you know? And that I think that's something that is so important. But you know, that's more or less what continues to inspire me.
No, I appreciate that. It's always weird when I'm in Panama or somewhere and you see like the huge, you know, like Kim Kardashian posters and the latest blockbuster films that have either been dubbed or sometimes they just play them in English with Spanish subtitles and people, it's like, it's so, you could just see how easily the imperialism, immaterially at least, can be delivered, never mind any other form. And then the contradictions are stark. Anyway, I just have more work. So one other question that I did have, and then I don't know how much more time you all, you know, we have, but yeah. Well, one point before I forget, there's one thing I did want to, I'm glad I wrote a note here. I think a good idea for you or anyone else, and maybe all of us who do make media content, I think it would be good to go back and revisit Glenn Ford's, well, all his work, but because he went to Libya with Cynthia McKinney and met with Gaddafi, and they, you know, I can't remember exactly, but I'm sure he must have written about it at least once, if not several times, you know, and meeting Gaddafi and the Green Book and all of that, it might be good to go back and revisit some of that, just to see, not just specific to Libya, but all the other connections that that Glenn would have been making back at that time that would still be relevant today. So one question that I did have within, when you're building in the Latin American context, and I'm very glad you made the point about race in Latin America, because that is a major under-discussed, and even within Latin America, under openly discussed and admitted to sometimes issue. But I did have a question here about, you know, with like in Black communities here, a lot of the resistance to adopting left or communist, Marxist, et cetera, politics is this idea that those ideas are Eurocentric. Does that same argument come up as much in Latin American context? Like, we can't get with the white man stuff. We need to find another path.
I think that's a fascinating question. I think it's an important question to keep in mind. I think it really depends on the country that we're talking about, because another thing to consider within Latin America and the Caribbean is that there's a vast difference between, let's say, Argentina and Chile and Mexico, which have very industrialized, advanced economies, obviously not to the level of Western Europe or the US, than compared to Haiti or Honduras or to Dominican Republic or even parts of Panama, right? Outside of Panama City. Even within Latin America and the Caribbean, there are a lot of discrepancies within what Marx talks about, the unequal development of capitalism, right? Some places have the core and the periphery, right? The cores, you have major cities, Bogota, Buenos Aires, Mexico City, where capitalism is concentrated. The peripheries, Haiti, you know, Honduras, Paraguay, you know, Dominican Republic, those areas are still in the level of feudalism in many ways. You know, you go to certain parts of Haiti, you go to certain parts of Central America, you feel like you're in the 1800s because of the level of development. And that's not to say that capitalism is a good thing, but within the transformation of class consciousness, right, you still have a feudal era relations of production, right, where it's not even factories and wages, it's like land where people literally live. Like in Honduras, where my family's from, that's how it is. And a lot of times when you buy land, you get the family that lives on the land, you know, that are trabajadores or workers, you know, and that's like, that's some reactionary feudal shit. And that still exists today. I think in terms of the race question and Marxism and the left, let me first address its phenomena within the more industrialized sectors of the left in certain countries. I think in Western countries, and I think in more industrialized countries of Latin America, where there's a left, that definitely is a phenomena. And I think part of that is the rise of the synthetic left, the rise of what is called the Congress for Cultural Freedom. We know that the CIA, since the 50s and the 60s, they totally changed up their strategy of anti-communism, right? Because in the lead up to the World War II, from about 1919 to 1945, the strategy of US imperialism and the CIA was scaring the crap out of people about communism, making it seem radical. They were like, communism is this radical system that's going to overthrow everything. It's going to change everything. Well, guess what? To a lot of people of color and poor people in all over the world, that was actually very good to hear. That was exciting, because their current circumstances were pretty backward, were oppressive. They're like, yeah, we don't give a fuck about this current system. We want something new. And so what happened is that after World War II, you have the creation of the Congress for Cultural Freedom. You have the creation of the State of Israel, and also their advisors who advised the CIA at this time in creating the synthetic left, the fake left, the Frankfurt School, right? Postmodernism. This is the rise of postmodernism.
Are you talking trash about the Frankfurt School, my man Theodore Adorno and all of them?
Theodore Adorno, in my
grad school classes, I used to dig their work until Adorno said he doesn't like jazz, and then I was like, oh.
Right. Yeah. No. Yeah. It's, you know, I don't want to be those like puritanical people who are like, read this. I think everybody should read everything.
Yeah.
What's interesting about the Frankfurt School and Adorno and a lot of these postmodernists is they're like, the problem is organization. It's the problem is conformity. The problem is authoritarianism. And so what happened is that in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, as you have all these revolutionary movements in Africa and Asia and Latin America that are militant, that are disciplined, that are, you know, they all working together, collectivists, right? They all have popular art where they pray, they have a leader that they praise. Then you have the rise of this sort of latte, soy left, liberal left, cafe left. That's like, oh, that's authoritarian. That's horrible. That's not so, that's not horizontal enough for me. And so what happens is that as time progresses, the 70s, 80s, 90s, the CIA and the NED, they fund these postmodernists, they fund these synthetic leftists to promote individualism, to promote, and a lot of, you know, no offense, I have some great anarchist friends, a lot of anarchism was weaponized as well against revolutionary Marxist-Leninist movements as a counterweight to that, right? And we saw that happen, especially in Latin America and the Caribbean. But so basically what happened is that part of that synthetic new left idea is that taking away the economic base of society, right? Because Marxism, the theory of Marxism, Leninism, and this is Thomas Sankara followed this, Amilcar Cabral, all of the revolutionaries, they Marxism, Leninism is about understanding that the primary contradiction, the base, is the mode and relations of production. Capitalist system is responsible for the problems that we see in the world, for slavery, for racism, for imperialism. The capitalist mode of production and economics determines this superstructure, right? And that is called economic determinism. And that is what many communists throughout history have put forward. And that's the view as well that, I follow. That's not to say that race and gender and all these things don't exist. Not at all. Because that's another extreme that I think is not good, because there is a national race, all these different discrepancies. But those are a result of the mode and relations of production that arose within capitalism. And so what happens with postmodernism, with a lot of these new synthetic left, they remove that. They say that Marx is a Euro settler, that he's evil, that he's a white man's ideology, and that anybody who follows him is horrible. And so what happens is that instead of attacking communism from the right, instead of saying it's evil, it's going to radicalize everything, they're attacking it from the left now. They're saying it's not radical enough. It's only focused on class. We have to go even further. And that has been a dominant trend that we've seen happen, for example, in Bolivia during the 2019 coup attempt against Evo Morales. You had quote-unquote anarcho-feminist groups that were protesting Evo Morales for being a right-wing conservative. You know what I'm saying? You had CIA-backed, US-backed protesters who had an anarchist aesthetic to them protesting Evo Morales. Same thing in Nicaragua, 2018, the coup attempt against Daniel Ortega and the Sandinistas. You had the USAID and the imperialists backing these women's rights groups, women's liberation groups, indigenous liberation groups, and saying, you know, indigenous lives matter, take down the Sandinista. You know, so it's like those scary movies where you have like the good guy, the protagonist who's fighting evil, and then they clone him and make like an evil version of him. And like, and it's kind of like that, right? So they're using, they're stealing the aesthetics of the left and weaponizing them for empire. And that is happening in Latin America and the Caribbean. And that is happening, especially in the big cities, right? That is why you had in Venezuela, you know, a lot of the student protesters against Maduro and the socialist movement in Venezuela come from the private universities, right? You had a lot of the bourgeois academia students coming out and protesting. The same thing happened in Nicaragua. Same thing happened as well in Bolivia. And as well in Cuba with the San Isidro, quote unquote, movement, you have USAID, NED funding these underground hip hop movements in Cuba saying patria y vida, right? Fatherland and life, and using these slogans to protest the Cuban government. So that is a new, but definitely a rising phenomena. It wasn't as prevalent as it is in the US, for example, but it's definitely happening more and more. But as a source of optimism in Haiti, for example, you don't see that. At least I haven't seen that. I was in Haiti in 2019 twice during the protests, shooting some video. And when I was there, I saw people waving. I saw this one guy who had a Russian and a Soviet flag, and it had a picture of Putin and a picture of Stalin. And it was like, you know, down with the US, France, and Canada, because they call it the Triple Alliance, right? The Imperialist Alliance. People in Haiti, they love Venezuela, they love Cuba. They support, you know, it's a whole different mindset, because also, again, the level of economic development in Haiti is not what it is in some of these more advanced countries. So I think it's a phenomenon, like the postmodern kind of left is definitely more of a phenomenon in countries that have undergone more of a developed capitalist path, if that makes sense.
No, it does. And I know, you know, man, is the one thing that I'll say that I will continue to struggle with is the piece about economic determinism. Mm. And I don't know, I don't know, we probably don't have time to do this now. Plus I want to go back and reread a couple things. In particular, I'm thinking of this essay this letter, I think, that Engels wrote. I can't remember who he was writing to now, but in a book I have that one of my favorites from them is somebody put together a book of Marx and Engels called On the United States. And it's just letters that they were writing and stuff they were writing about the US. One of which I always thought was funny was when Marx wrote Lincoln and said, "Thank you for freeing your slaves, because now you freed all the working people in Europe." Which I thought was always but Engels said, because Engels actually writes a letter in there where, as I remember it, he's saying, he doesn't use this language, but he seems to be saying, we are not economic determinists, and that people have been missing this about me and Marx for a long time. The reason mm-hmm. we talk about economics is because that, to your point, is the engine of social relations right now. But the issue is the social relations. Mm-hmm. So ever since I read that, that's where I always keep coming back to. I keep wanting to say, even Engels was acknowledging that years later, Nkrumah, Ture, Fanon would all be right.
Yeah, of course. No, I think most definitely. I think that the superstructure, and because I think a lot of times when we say economic determinism, we're not just saying that economics is the only determining factor, but it's the leading determining factor. But part of the dialectic, right, you have the thesis, but you also have the antithesis that creates a new synthesis. And the important thing to remember about the dialectic is that it's not necessarily rigidly saying it's only economics. There are so many social, the superstructure, right? Political events, racial events, social events, religious events, the superstructure also influences the base, right? That also influences. Great analogy is going back to the example you made earlier when you went to Panama and you see all these billboards of like Kim Kardashian, right? And so what happens is that these things that we see in the superstructure of like beauty standards, of what it normative behavior, what it means to look good or to be good, that influences the economy, because now people are out getting plastic surgery. Now people are out getting certain outfits. So 100%, you know, the superstructure most definitely influences the base in the same way that the base influences the superstructure. I like to compare it to like a soil and flowers. If you have, for example, soil that is poisoned or that has horrible nutrients in it, which we can compare to capitalism, the flowers that blossom or whatever grows from it is going to be horrible because it's a reflection of the soil that's corrupted. But if it's good soil, if it's rich in nutrients, it can blossom some beautiful flowers, trees that will again release the seeds of new soil, new plants. And it's this sort of a dynamic process within nature. And it's very different from the metaphysical and very bourgeois understanding of liberal and conservative politics and philosophy, where they view things as something is this or something is that, And it can't be both at the same time, right? This is why people don't understand that we can defend Russia against imperialism. We can defend these countries against empire and still have our own critiques of these countries, right? They don't understand that. They're like, are you with them or against them? You know, A is A and B is B. They don't understand the dialectic that they're, everything has a thesis and an antithesis, even movements, right? Even when movements arise, Black Lives Matter is a great example. You have the base grassroots. I remember when BLM came out, when it was the protests, the grassroots, so many radical militant people, the Pan-Africanist flag, really amazing comrades. And then you have the contradiction where you also had the NGO elements, right? The liberals who are like, oh, let's go with the Democrats. Let's start getting the Ford Foundation money. So it's you, within every movement, you see these contradictions take place. And I think that's the beauty of Marxism, that it's not a religion. It's not a set way of viewing things, but it's a way of understanding reality in a flexible way, that the universe is this, is matter in motion that is constantly influencing one and each other. And I think it's something that is well worth studying and is beautiful, you know?
Yeah, no question. Absolutely. So the only other thing that I wanted to bring up, at least for now, is because I know, again, I know we you know, we'll just have to have more conversations. Is really just that I do want to find ways of not only partnering more in terms of our platforms, but beyond. And so I just wanted to publicly invite that and encourage that and figure out ways that we can cross-pollinate because I really appreciate what you've put together here. And I look forward to continuing to learn and build. But in particular, I gotta, you know, I and I don't mean, you know, my family is wonderful, and so I'm not trying to, you know, but like the way I think of them is that there is this, they are the perfect example of folks that come, particularly the folks, you know, my in-laws, you know, they come, I mean, out of every hood everybody has ever seen, in particularly in Central and South America or outside of the United States. I mean, that's where they come from. I mean, it's and there is that there is already the, we don't mess with gringos. We don't mess with, you know, we like the hostility towards the United States, particularly because of the canal zone in the history. And I mean, it's just there. I mean, it's delicious even, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, I love it. Like, it's just, it's certainly not organized. It's certainly not overtly radically political. You know, my brother-in-law is a great MC, and he took the rap name Ideal Baiano in tribute to King Baiano, the Maroon coming out of Central America and Panama. So there is all of that, but when I engage politically, or want to engage politically, there's not that, I don't know. It's a different level of struggle. So like, I really appreciated finding your channel because, not only the politics, but also because a lot of it is in English, and I have to admit that I haven't caught up to my in-laws in the Spanish, and certainly not at the level of these kinds of conversations. Then a lot of them, you know, who are here, speak English as well. So in terms of the political stuff, it's just great. So I just wanted to say all of that to you publicly. I really appreciate it. And I'm thankful that you invited me here. Cause I really just wanted to build with you, and encourage you to keep it up.
Most definitely, Comrade Jared. I mean, the work you do is great. And I totally know what you mean about the frustration. I've had the same frustration in Honduras as well for many years, because the conditions are ripe for revolution. Mm-hmm. The conditions were always there. The people understand. It's the same sentiment in Honduras as well as like Panama and in Haiti as well. People are like they understand what the empire does. They understand imperialism. And I think a lot of times too, it's a matter of being patient with people and being like, you know, it's also very challenging when you're living under the boot of violence and repression every day. A lot of times people are traumatized, right? Like my family, you know, my dad, for example, he grew up in the hometown, the town in Honduras where the U.S. trained the Contras. So you had the U.S. military, Israel, drug cartels, the Contras, all these groups in this one little town where my dad grew up. Horrible violence, shootouts every day, horrible stuff. And he was traumatized by that. And he, in a way, almost wanted to just clock out and be like, I don't want to be involved in that.
Yeah, know? I believe and, that. Yeah, I see that.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And so no, I see like that. Sorry. Mm-hmm. No,
I feel like that's part of it.
No, I'm sure you're right, and I'm sure I've, and in fact, I know I see that in my family as well. There's a similar, and then they have that again. They were there for some of the conflicts against the U.S. military, trying to get them out of the canal zone, and you know, and of course the Panama the invasion. In 89, I mean, so like they were all front and center for all that, and they all come from all the neighborhoods that were most heavily hit. So but there has been sometimes, although that's why I asked that initial question, because I don't know to what extent the what I have felt in resisting some radical politics or even some of these ideas has been the sort of I don't know the traditional beef within black left circles of you know, Marx is too white, you know, we can't you know, like we can't, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm like, but you know, but read you could check it out a little bit, you know, like,
yeah,
like
yeah.
You know, like yeah. It doesn't have to.
Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Yeah, like you don't have to. You know, you don't have to put his picture up, and you don't have to. You know, yeah. What I mean, you don't have to. You know, pay tribute to him every whatever. But it's just like you don't have to not read him either. So, but anyway, that was it, man. But again, like I said, man, big shout out to you and your broader collective and crew. And I really appreciate this exchange, and I look forward to more.
Thank you so much, Comrade Jared. You're awesome. Your work is amazing, and I definitely hope to collaborate soon. You know, we'll talk offline about future collaborations. The stuff that you guys are doing is amazing. Please like and support Dr. Jared Abel's work, Professor of Communications and Africana Studies at Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland. Shout out to Baltimore. Shout out to also Comrade Erica Keynes. And Comrade Jared is the author of The Myth and Propaganda of Black Buying Power, an amazing book. Please give it a 5-star review if you see it online. And Jared is the host of the podcast, I Mix What I Like, and co-founder of Black Power Media. Please subscribe to Black Power Media, an amazing channel that has so many programs. That is also what I like about the channel, too. It's not just always down. It's not just like, oh, my God, these evil things are happening. It's like, yo, let's just chill and vibe out and listen to good music. I appreciate it. And that is part of a revolution, by the way. The revolution, I think that's what turns off a lot of people of color from white leftist circles, where it's just like, we're going to read the statement of the fourth proclamation. It's like, yo, let's get some music in here. Let's get some food. Hey, let's make it a party.
My man, Head Rock, man, shout out to Head Rock. He used to say all the time that, it's too many dry crackers in the movement, man. It's just dry.
Like, too many saltines.
And it's just dry, and that's so. Yeah. So we do, yeah. And I mean, and then selfishly, like I do want to have some fun, man. Like I mean, damn, yeah. You know what I mean? You know, like I don't want them to wipe out all of my enjoyment here. Even George Jackson had that line about, I've thought that something to the effect that we're only, you know, our purpose here is to gratify the mind, body, and soul. And I only started hating when I realized that they were injecting. How do you put it? Injecting mystification on intentionally, something like that. But it's like, that's really it. Like, I'm trying to chill. And if you all would stop messing with that, we could chill. But you don't want to chill. So we can't chill entirely, but a little bit at least.
make communism lit again. That's my slogan. I'm going to share with that. But
right, why Jared, not?
It's been a pleasure speaking with you, man. We'll right talk on, soon. Likewise. I have your email. We'll be in communication. Thank you so much, brother, for joining us. Shout out to everybody who's watching and listening. We're going to go out to some anti-fascist music. Viva la Quinta Brigada, the fight against fascism, the fight against NATO imperialism. Peace out, everybody. Thank you for watching and listening, and take care.
la quinta brigada, rumba la rumba la rumba la, viva la quinta brigada, rumba la rumba la rumba la, que nos cubrirá de glorias, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Que nos cubrirá de glorias, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Luchamos contra los moros, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Luchamos contra los moros, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Mercenarios y fascistas, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Mercenarios y fascistas, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Ejército del Ebro, rumba la rumba la rumba la. El ejército del Ebro, rumba la rumba la rumba la. La otra noche el río cruzó, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. La otra noche el río cruzó, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Ya las fuerzas invasoras, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Ya las fuerzas invasoras, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Buena paliza les dio, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Buena paliza les dio, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Frentes de Granada, rumba la rumba la rumba la. En los frentes de Granada, rumba la rumba la rumba la. No tenemos días lunes, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. No tenemos días lunes, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Y tenemos días martes, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Y tenemos días martes, rumba la rumba la rumba la. Con los tanques y granadas, ay Carmela, ay Carmela. Con los tanques y granadas, ay Carmela, ay Carmela.